Good morning, good morning. I'm hopeful that you've joined us out there. I'm never sure if we're watching this live or recorded or live and recorded, but we feel free to mess up whether it's live or recorded, right? We don't edit anything, so it wouldn't change anything if we were not live because we're not going back and altering this video in any way. We hope that you're going to join us in your virtual setting. And soon, I hope to be back in personal setting with one another here in the building. But the church has gathered both virtually, near and far, all around the planet right now. And we are grateful to be celebrating this Sunday. In some of our more liturgical churches, this is the Sunday where Jesus' baptism is celebrated, celebrating the example set by him. As a man, obedient to the Father, so that we could follow along as well. In our particular church, we don't follow that particular guideline, and we'll be looking at the promises of God today, and hope that you are ready with your Bible and your notepad at home to take down any notes that the Spirit prompts you to record. We're going to begin by singing Build Your Kingdom Here, because that's where God builds his kingdom on earth with his people. Let's sing.
Build your kingdom here.
know, that's one of the things that Jesus talked about most was the kingdom of God on earth. He didn't speak nearly as often as the eventual kingdom fulfilled. He spoke of the kingdom of God on earth. I'm so glad that we get to be a part of that, that we sing that. I'm so glad we can survive that song. That's hard on my musicians to do that, so we'll give them a moment to recover. Been a hard week. Been an interesting week. Been a tragic week. Been a challenging week. But the sun came up on Thursday morning, and then it went down on Thursday night, and it came up again on Friday. Went down on Friday, and so on. And I imagine that our God, who has built resilience into his universe, will loan us some of that resilience for our nation and our people right now as well. Make no mistake, our God has blessed us in this country and given us the opportunity to serve him under our government and within our nation, within our society. And I look forward to seeing the restoration of God in our nation, especially through the kingdom, especially through the body of Christ. Praise God, we get to be a part of the solution and can avoid being a part of the problem. Looking forward to talking about some of God's promises today and how those can apply. The next song is called All My Hope. And when Crowder wrote this song, he had the nerve to say that all of his hope was in Jesus. He didn't say anything about government or about his bank account or about his abilities or about his talents. He said, all my hope is in Jesus. If you believe that, sing along with us that sentiment today.
I've been held by the Savior. I've felt fire from above. I've been down to the river. Yeah, I ain't the same, a prodigal return. I've worn shackles and chains. I've been freed and forgiven. And I'm not going back. I'll never be the same. There's a kind of thing that just breaks you down, brings you down to your knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two, yes, Lord, but then you pick me up. It's shown me what it means to be free. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. All my sins are forgiven. Oh, I've been washed by the blood. Let's sing it again.
Just got word that we're looking good today. In fact, I can assure you that don't have a video feed right now that everybody has a perfect hair day going on right now, right, band? Right, we're all perfect hair day. Actually, I'll describe the scene in front of you so you can feel like you're here with us. At least three of us are wearing flannel. I kind of look like the guy off the Brawny towel commercial right now, I just realized. I wanted to say that before somebody else did. So. Tanya's in all black because she does all black. That's what she does. The youngsters look cool. Matt's hair is still growing out from last March. Pretty much, is it last March? Oh, yeah, yeah. And Dakota and Jesse looking cool back there in the back with their guitars. They look like rock stars. So now that you can picture what we look like, make sure that you're joining us. It's just like being in a meeting sometimes, on a Zoom meeting, where when your camera is turned off, you're not really paying attention. Well, pay attention even if the camera's not working. Because first of all, it may come back on at any time. So you got to be ready for that. Secondly, we need you to engage with us. Worship and the study of God's Word is a collective endeavor, and we are better together. Let's keep singing together. Our next one is called Hear Our Praises. Let's sing together.
Hear our singing.
Back in the old days, this would be a radio show anyway. Does that mean you have video back? Oh man, I was going to make a face at Tanya, but I can't do it now because everybody would see it. Well, welcome back visually. Hope you've been with us virtually anyway. You can't really be virtually with someone. You either are with them or you are not. Electronically, maybe you've been joining us. The next one we're going to sing is called Be Strong in the Lord. It's a hymn. It gives us encouragement to one another to be strong in the Lord. And it's something that we ought to pay attention to, especially this week, as we've seen the weakness of mankind on display all around the world, and in particular even in our bastion of democracy. We are strong not in our systems and not in our efforts and not in our achievements, but we are strong in the Lord and the Lord alone. Let's sing together, Be Strong in the Lord. Very good to hear right now. But I remembered this week where encouragement, as we were singing that song, from a number of people to do some things that are supposed to be involuntary. Like relax, you're supposed to be able to relax, to breathe, to unclench your jaw, to relax your shoulders. Because as humans, when we're under stress or duress or anxious about something, all of those things become difficult to control. Your body becomes tense, your breathing becomes erratic, your heart rate goes up, your dopamine levels rise. All kinds of weird physiological things happen when you allow the concerns or fears of the world to overcome you. We don't have to worry about this stuff. No matter what happens, literally no matter what happens, we're good. Literally, no. If the world ends tomorrow, we're better, actually. We're not just good, we're better. And so those of us that have the hope of Jesus Christ in our life ought to be showing this hope even in times of turmoil. To take a breath, breathe in the hope of your Father, recognize the salvation of the Son, seek the guidance of the Spirit, live out the promise of being a Christ follower in a world that is shaken, but will be restored by our God. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Amen. Let's sing.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my
attention today for maybe a few minutes. Hopefully we do that more often than just a few minutes. But Father, we pray that today your Spirit will speak loudly to us and clearly to us and compel us to know and to do your word. In your name we pray. Amen.
So in full disclosure, I wondered this past 3 days if I should be addressing specifically the issues that took place in our nation Wednesday afternoon from the pulpit in this message in its entirety. And I didn't feel compelled to do that, but make no mistake, I have, as you, hopefully, plenty of thoughts about the riots that occurred at our nation's capital. And I do not intend to ignore those in this moment where I'm speaking to you either. I will sprinkle throughout this message some of the thoughts that I believe line up with the scriptures we're looking at. But make no mistake, this is not something that any pastor or any leader should be ignoring on this day as they stand behind our pulpit. These were some of the most significant events that have occurred in our nation's history, and especially in our lifetimes. Who knew that 2021 would start out even potentially more tragic than 2020 was in our nation? A couple of things to pay attention to before we get into our message today, so that I don't forget these announcements later. But normally, this particular Sunday is our anniversary Sunday. And in fact, it's a time where we gather together. We get to take a mandatory picture. Everybody loves that picture. Of everyone, as it were, an actual snapshot in time of who is attending the well on that particular day. And then reflect on God's blessing on us to have sustained us for so many years. Is this 10 or 9? Completing 10 or starting 10? Completing 10. So this is like our 10th anniversary coming up. And what I can assure you is we're gonna throw a party, but it's not today. So you didn't miss it. We will delay it. We had originally thought we would push it around spring break in March. And that may still take place, but at this point, we're not going to set a date on that just yet. There's another announcement I would like to make from the pulpit. Am I permitted to make an announcement, or is that for later? Okay, all right. I was eyeballing a couple folks who were here because I didn't ask them if I would be permitted to, but I would like to announce to our church group that doesn't already know that Dakota and Lily became engaged yesterday. It's hard for me to say that without, you know, choking up a little bit right there. Pretty excited, and this summer sometime, I understand there's going to be a heck of a party where we gather together and celebrate the beginning of their married life. And I want to congratulate you guys for doing this thing right. And I love you very much. I'm looking forward to the party, even though it's really weird to see one of my nieces getting married right now. Man. And I was thinking about how I've literally known Dakota since he was in diapers, and then thinking, oh, you're that old guy that talks about those things now. And that's me, I guess. So I'm so glad to congratulate you two and to know that you are building your life in Christ together. So today's topic again is promises. Promises, but terrible promises. If you be good, I will give you ice cream when we get home, said my parents, never. Not once. For some reason, I can't recall my father ever bribing me to behave appropriately. On the other hand, I can recall many occasions where I was assured of dire punishment if I did not do what I was supposed to do and knew what I was supposed to do. It's an interesting approach, this expectation of correct actions, often paired with a guarantee of consequences if I didn't do what I knew to be the right thing. I don't think, frankly, and this is probably a shortcoming in my personality, that we should be praised for doing the right thing. I think we should just do the right thing because it's the right thing. Now, I'm taught and I'm encouraged to encourage people when they've done the right thing because it creates a habit of right things, and I get that, but I also know that you should do the right thing because it is the right thing by definition. So I understand my dad's perspective and my mom's perspective to some extent, that I wasn't praised or bribed to do the right thing, but I was assured of consequences if I did the wrong thing. And to be clear, my upbringing was one of consistent example of where good behavior would bring about good results. The core values and the habits of mind and behavior and the clear moral compass that were instilled in me over so many years have served me well, and it is my desire that my own children and my grandchildren, one of which will be arriving this June, will learn the same lessons, the lessons of hard work and honesty and frugality and tenacity and consistency and trustworthiness and on. These were all modeled for me and taught to me by my parents. The truth found in God's word, the direction found through the Spirit, and the salvation found through the Son were and still are the foundation stones upon which my family was built, and which I pray will continue to be the foundation for my family for generations. It shouldn't be any surprise then for Christ followers to recognize that such behavior and directions for following these values have been found in the Word of God since the very beginning of God's relationship with His people. From the very beginning, in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 1 through 9, this is what God says through His prophet. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land you are crossing the Jordan to possess, that you and your children and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all His decrees and commands that I give you, so that you may enjoy a long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey. Hey, listen. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. That's what the prophet was saying. Listen to me. Be jarred out of your boredom and your distraction, and listen to me. Obey the decrees of the Lord carefully. Follow the commands of Yahweh to the nth degree, because if you do, you will live long and prosperous lives. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you and you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised. Listen to me, O Israel. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. This is called the Shema. This is the foundation on which everything that followed was built. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Don't offer them to your children. Don't suggest them to your children. Impress them, which means that you've left an imprint on your children. I remember in middle school in Marquand, Missouri, they still had paddles in the classrooms, wooden paddles. And I took to making paddles for my teachers in woodshop class as a gift. I don't know what was wrong with me. Maybe I was hoping they wouldn't be used on me if I created them. And I would make these fearsome, like, cricket bats. They were huge, out of oak or walnut, and cut them out and sand them. And then I had a brilliant idea. I could take the initials of my teacher and use a router to carve them in a mirror image, so that if they ever had to be applied theoretically, there would be an impression of the teacher's initials on the backside of the child receiving the Board of Education. That's kind of warped thinking, isn't it? My paddles were really popular with the teachers. They loved those. I don't know that they were used, but they were displayed. The idea was that the lesson to be learned would be impressed upon the recipient in a way where they would remember it. Both punishment and blessing can be impressed, and we are encouraged through this scripture to impress the Lord's commands on our children. I may go home and get my bandsaw out and see if I could make Christy a paddle. You might need one. Not with the teenagers, of course. They're perfectly well behaved, but the little one coming up, he might need something to impress on him what he needs to learn. Talk about them, he says, when you sit down and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up, tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them to your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. It's almost as if God was serious about us knowing what he expected us to do. You know, you could choose a different way to go with your life and family, but I sure am glad my parents and my in-laws chose to follow the God of all gods. As I mentioned before, we often only spend time within the scriptures which promise positive results from our relationship with God. I mean, Joel Osteen has made a career of this, right? Everything that he preaches is about the positive promises of God, and not only borders up to but completely goes over the gospel of prosperity. And he has never, and I don't think will ever, preach on the promises of God's judgment. And many fall into this trap. You see, it's much easier to consume the honey of Scripture than to deal with the vinegar of Scripture. It's much easier to accept the comforting blessings of a God that loves us and wants to hold us and save us than it is to deal with a God whose white, hot wrath has been and will be poured out on those who ignore him and reject him. But today we're not going to look at those positive scriptures nearly as much as we're going to look at those that are promised to us equally as a result of our rebellion against the God who loves us. Like my parents, there is no doubt of God's love for his children. And like my parents, as well, there is no doubt of their will to enforce behavior through negative consequences, either by allowing the natural course of events to take place or by sort of speeding along the lesson through their own physical intervention, if you know what I mean, on occasion. But either way, my folks were willing to do the hard thing, by the way. It's not easy to punish your child. It's really not easy to allow your child to stumble by their own stupid decisions. But in both cases, my parents were willing to allow the negative consequences of rebellious actions to take place. The word is very clear that there are consequences on how we live our lives. And it speaks of the results of these choices occurring both within our lifetimes and after we've died, as we receive the judgment of God. There are promises throughout Scripture that say you will receive the just due for your works. You will be rewarded according to what you have done. And over we see this promise in Scripture. In fact, there will be, because our God is perfectly just, our judgment is perfectly deserved. And the promise of this perfect consistency and justice should be terrifying, quite honestly, unless we've chosen to not believe it to be real. There will be no escaping this day of judgment, according to Scripture. Some people worry about the Lord's return. But one way or another, we will meet him, either within our lifetime or one millisecond after our lifetime ends. Every single one of us will face the Lord in a few years' time, at best. And the things that we have done will not be laid aside, but they will be laid bare perfectly for our Lord to judge. And we will be given the perfect judgment that we deserve. The balance of consequences of our choices is all throughout the Word, but there are few places that it is more starkly presented than in the 28th chapter of Deuteronomy. So if you've got your Bibles, turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28, where we see some really clear if-then statements. These were things that I learned about in geometry. I call conditional statements. They were parts of proofs that we had to memorize. And the way that geometry works is it would make a statement or a proof that says, if these conditions exist, then this occurs, period. It was a proof or a statement of fact. And in Deuteronomy 28, it gives us conditional proofs, the if-then statements of our behavior based on God's standard. Whether this is, some people think that the statements in Deuteronomy 28 apply to Israel historically. They're called preterists, or people who believe that these particular judgments have already occurred on Israel. Some don't believe that, and I don't think either makes any difference, to be honest with you, because the if-then statements are still very applicable to us today. Whether this is something that's already happened or something that is yet to happen, we should still read this and be honest enough to affirm the realities of consequences that we see for our own lives, for our families, for our communities, and our nation. And by the way, there's a lot of things that have been going through my mind as I've watched videos of what occurred in our nation's capital. But one of the more compelling words of advice I read recently this week was to avoid this idea of whataboutism that is so prevalent in our society. I know they did it, but what about what they did? I know he did this, but what about what she did? I know I might have done this, but what about what they did? And when we see the example of Nathan confronting David in Psalms, where David is confronted by his sin, he didn't say, well, what about Saul? What did he do? He didn't say, what about the heathens around me? He wrote Psalm 51, is what David did, which is an abject confession of sin and reliance on God in the face of judgment. And so we need to have that same tendency, not to say, well, what about what these people did or what about those people didn't do, but to accept in our own lives, and frankly, to expect others to accept in their own lives their own choices. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1. The first few verses are back to the positive affirmations for what we do if we actually follow God's will. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, this is the setup, because we're going to move beyond these. But make no mistake, our God has given us both options. If you follow me, these things will occur. If you deny me, these things will occur. And you can decide today, I'll believe God or I won't. But this is what the Scripture says. If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully follow all his commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations on earth. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. The if-then statements are just clear as they can possibly be right there. Now, I recognize that this particular word is given to a corporate audience. It's given to a collective people, to tribes and a nation, but these apply both equally to us individually and to our collection of people in our community and nation. If you follow God, these things will happen. Verse 3, you'll be blessed in the city and you'll be blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed, and the crops of your land and the young of your livestock, the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks. In other words, your children will be blessed. And the things you own will be blessed, and you will prosper as a nation. Your basket and your kneading trough will be blessed. That means your bellies will be full. You will have the food that you need. You'll be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. Even your travel will be blessed. The time you leave your home and the time you come back will be blessed. The Lord will grant that the enemies, I love this, they will, the enemies that rise up against you will be defeated before you. They will come at you from one direction, but flee from you in seven. I love that word picture. The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hand to. That's about our work being blessed and our savings being blessed. The Lord, your God, will bless you in the land he is giving you. It even says that if you follow God, that those around you will be blessed because of your obedience to him. The Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on oath, if you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in obedience to him. Then all the people on the earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will fear you. The Lord will grant you abundant prosperity and the fruit of your womb, the young of your livestock, the crops of your ground, in the land he swore to your ancestors to give you. The Lord will open the heavens, the storehouse of his bounty, to send rain on your land in season and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations but borrow from none. The Lord will make you the head, not the tail. I like that. If you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be at the top, never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from the commands I give you today, to the right or to the left, following other gods and serving them. Man, if we just stopped on verse 14, we could leave here with our heads held high. If you follow my commands, you will prosper. Your children will prosper. Your community will prosper. The name of the Lord will be great among all the nations. Your enemies can't overcome you. You will have what you need and more if you follow my commands. Now, that is not to say that bad stuff doesn't happen to good people. It's not to say that you're not going to have to work for your food or earn your keep. It is not saying that if you just follow God's commands, your bank account will magically be filled up. It is not teaching that nonsense. It's also not teaching that the more godly that you are, the more wealthy you are. So don't read into that what is not in that. Jesus said, God said comprehensively, if you follow my commands, I've designed this universe to benefit you. I've designed your life to be of value, more and greater value, if you follow me. And if you do not, it's about to get bad up in here, y'all. I can't even read to you all of the balance of this chapter. It is for mature audiences only. I'm going to give you some of it, but I won't get into the deep, dark parts that are in the latter half of Deuteronomy chapter 28, because it is fearsome. Let's get started, though. However, if you do not obey the Lord your God and do not carefully follow all his commands I'm giving you today, all these curses will come on you and overtake you, colon. That means there's going to be a list that comes after. This is a really terrifying thing to consider. Unless you are conveniently located in either ignorance or you've decided God doesn't exist. In which case, you can relax. Because if God doesn't exist, you got no worries. If you think he's lying or the scriptures are wrong, then you're in good shape, I guess, because you're not going to feel any discomfort at all. But if you believe the word of God is the word of God, we better pay attention and be of sober mind and heart. Verse 16, you will be cursed in the city and cursed in the country. I want to tell you that a promise and a curse coming from God are the same thing. They are a guarantee. They are perfect. They are deserved. They are unequivocal. They are powerful. They will occur. Both a curse and a promise for prosperity coming from God are equally meted out. Your basket and your kneading trough will be cursed. In other words, your food will not be nourishing. The fruit of your womb will be cursed. That means your children will suffer. The crops of your land and the cows of your herds and the lambs of your flocks, the things that you put your hands to, the work of your life will be cursed. You'll be cursed when you come in and cursed when you go out. Man, think about this. Think about the misery that awaits all people and all nations and all communities that ignore God. And it doesn't mean that they don't have a Big Mac once in a while or that they don't still have children once. It means that their lives will be cursed. I look at people who are miserable sometimes, who have ignored God, and go, boy, I don't even understand why you can't see why your life is so bad right now. Why would you keep living this life? There's a tragically sad bar right over here by my admin office. Tragic little cesspool of a bar. I go in it about once a week. This week I went into it because somewhere around the New Year's weekend, they not only parked in our parking lot and made a mess, and they leave beer cans and condoms and cigarette butts, disgusting remains of people living a decadent life, but they decided that they would leave out through the field, which was muddy, and destroyed the field, tore up our throwing ring, knocked down part of a fence. Just, it looked like a bunch of pigs had wallowed in this field out here. And I was just incensed by that disrespect. And I saw a truck parked in front of the bar, and I went over to the bar. It said closed, and I was beaten on the door. And they didn't open the door. Well, later on, there were two or three trucks there. And I went back, because I know somebody's there now, and I beat on the door, and I hear them saying in Spanish, "We're not open." So I beat on the door a little louder. They said, "Louder, we're not open." And I beat on the door a little bit more. May have kicked it a little bit, just to make sure it was being communicated that I needed to speak to someone. The door opened up, and this really sad-looking gangster opened the door. Tatted up, dressed to the nines, and there were two ladies off to this corner smoking and trying to eat a honey bun or something for breakfast. The place just has a stench of sweat and beer and cigarettes and sadness, frankly. And in that moment, I shifted from being angry to being sad. I looked at those, there were about six people in there, and went, how broken these people are. To have given their lives to pursuing sin and caught it, and now it has them. And the likelihood is that most of those people will never turn their gaze to Jesus Christ. What a sad thing to see those humans made in God's image now receiving the curses that have been embedded in Scripture since the Scriptures were written. Hearts just broken, lives just broken, and not even realizing that as bad and miserable as their lives are right now, it's only going to get infinitely worse. What a tragedy. What a sad thing to know that our world is full of people who are feeling this curse when they come in and when they go out. Verse 20, it says, the Lord will send on you curses, confusion, and rebuke in everything you put your hand to until you are destroyed and come to sudden ruin because of the evil you have done in forsaking Him. What a fearsome warning. The Lord will plague you with diseases until He has destroyed you from the land you are entering to possess. The Lord will strike you with wasting disease, with fever and inflammation and scorching heat and drought, with blight and mildew, which will plague you until you perish. The sky over your head will be bronze, the ground beneath you iron. The Lord will turn the rain of your country into dust and powder. It will come down from the skies until you are destroyed. What would a loving God do these things? To turn us back to Him. Our God desires that none should perish. No, not one. He has come that we might have life more abundantly and avoid the inevitable curse of our sin if we will but follow Him and His commands. If we do not, the consequences will be eternal and overwhelming. The Lord will cause you to be defeated before your enemies. You'll come at them from one direction, but flee from them in seven, and you will become a thing of horror to all the kingdoms on earth. Your carcasses will be food for all the birds and the wild animals, and there will be no one to frighten them away. The Lord will afflict you with the boils of Egypt and with tumors, festering sores, and the itch from which you cannot be cured. The Lord will afflict you with blindness and madness and confusion of mind. At midday, you will grope about like a blind person in the dark. You will be unsuccessful in everything you do. Day after day, you'll be oppressed and robbed with no one to rescue you. How do you feel about that? Promise of God. How do you feel about it? Sure, glad that's Old Testament. God doesn't do that anymore. Thank God it's a new covenant. Thank God God doesn't give us what we deserve. He doesn't allow us to stumble and fall. He holds us up even when we deserve. No, that's not what I read when I read this. This terrifies me when I read this. You know, what follows is even worse than what we've already been warned of. And I'm not going to read this, but it talks about enemies conquering and famine and siege and slavery and rape and theft and cannibalism, where the people of God will be so decadent, depraved, and at the bottom of their lives that they actually eat their own young. That's not hyperbole. It actually occurred. In the Israelite nation, a nation chosen by God, there was a time in their lives where they were so depraved and so destroyed, they ate their own children. The choices are so clear. From our vantage point and with such hindsight, how could an entire nation turn from the beauty of a loving God who wanted to prosper them into the temporary pleasure of materialism and sex and doing the things the world offered them? Why would they trade that short-term pleasure for the long-term curse? The same reason we do. Who would choose what the Bible calls curses, confusion, and rebuke, which are promised to those who turn from God? You know, many, if not most people, choose to turn a blind eye to the truth that has been present from the very beginning of God's relationship with mankind and with man and woman individually. As it says in the very first verse of the next chapter, these are the terms of the covenant. These are the terms of the covenant. I've recently been in contract negotiations with an entity. where they made an offer and I made a counter offer and I got some of what I wanted. And they made another offer and they got a little more and then I made a counter offer. We're almost at the end of what I think I'm going to be able to get for my organization. And I don't want to push the limits and ruin the relationship, but I know that I'm in a position to negotiate the best deal for my organization. There is no negotiation with God. These are the terms of the covenant. You may take them or you may leave them, but they are the terms of your humanity. You'll follow the God that created you to be in relationship with Him, or you will reject Him. If you will follow God, you will receive the blessings. If you don't, you'll receive the curses. That's what the scriptures say. I could go on and on, bearing down on these curses. The promises of God, which are the promises of our deserved results of our willful disobedience. But as I mentioned, the balance of the scripture is sort of PG, and I would let you guys read that on your own. You know, in our lives, we need to be aware that most curses that come upon us are incremental, but no less inevitable. Because the results of our sin are rarely instantaneous, we're tempted to flinch a little bit after we sin. But when we are not immediately struck down by God, we frolic along our way thinking maybe God has other things to do than to mess about with my little mess. Surely God has bigger fish to fry than me. He didn't mind that I did this, that I lied on this, that I cheated on my homework, that I did this with my boyfriend or girlfriend, that I did this on my taxes, that I did this in my representation to someone else. He doesn't mind. Obviously, he didn't mind because he didn't whoop my butt the minute he knew about it right away, and he let me get away with it. That is false thinking. In fact, we become reliant on our own forgetfulness of our sin and our own short-term memory when it comes to our indiscretions. But make no mistake, the Bible says our God does not forget. Neither does the effect of our sin simply disappear. And the effect and accrual of sin in our lives and in those around us is undeniable if we just pay attention to it. I often look at someone who is depicted in the media as having committed a heinous crime, and I think that person has come so far, so fast from when they were a third grader in elementary school learning to read. From the day they were born and held by a mother who nurtured them. From that coach who spoke truth into their life when they played ball for them in high school. How did they become that person that murdered someone? That raped someone, that harmed their own child? Well, it was incremental. It was one step at a time down these dark pathways. And the effects of sin, the curse of the results of sin are always present. We might even be thinking right now that we're coasting along in life, thinking everything is okay, or at least that we can maintain what we have, and all of a sudden our sky comes crashing down. And this happens individually. It happens in families. It happens in communities. And this past week, we were reminded that it can happen in a nation. My sister-in-law, Megan, grew up in Venezuela. It was the most prosperous country in South America. The most prosperous, affluence, oil-rich nation, stable, peaceful, beautiful nation that in a few short years has completely turned itself upside down. Its people are starving now. Its government is in shambles. And it happened almost overnight. Every nation falls almost often cataclysmically because the people within the nation aren't paying attention to the termites that are chewing at the foundations, the sin and depravity that are undermining the foundations until all of a sudden the thing comes crashing down. If there is anything redeeming about what we saw last week, it should be a jarring awake of the church and people of good conscience to speak truth in a nation that has forgotten that we were founded on God's principles. There is no doubt in my mind that this nation will pass away as every other nation passes away. But perhaps if we turn and seek God, He'll restore this nation to what He intended it to be. The same thing in our lives. This is my encouragement to us. Let us not be the fools who willingly trade the blessings of God for the curses of our own sin. Let us strive, work, try to follow the God who wants us to have joy and blessing and comfort and prosperity and happiness rather than chasing our own stupid, prideful, foolish, sinful natures down what the scriptures say is a certain path to destruction. You know, there are promises in the scriptures, thousands of living a life opposed to God and His decrees. And there are promises of the consequences that we face after we have died. And we have the opportunity to look both within our lives and the lives of others to see if that's affirmed in the fact of humanity, which I would say it's pretty unequivocally clear, that sin has repercussions. Or we can look to follow our God, which says He desires our well-being. You know, what I've noticed is that all of the things that were mentioned in the first passages in this passage in Deuteronomy deal with basically four areas: the health and well-being of our physical selves, our emotional selves, our financial or stewardship selves, and our spiritual selves. And in all four of those areas, the areas that make up our lives, God promises that He will bless us if we follow Him. And in all four of those areas, He promises that our sin will curse us if we don't follow Him. We'll decline in health, we'll decline in prosperity, we'll decline in emotional health, we'll decline in spiritual health. I don't like to go to the doctor. You can ask my wife. I do not. The only reason I would even go take a physical is for a while they were paying me to take a physical, and she said, go get that $200. Go get your physical. Then they stopped offering $200 for the physical, and I don't think I've gone back for the physical since. I don't like to go to the doctor. But what I've noticed about me is when I go to a doctor, I listen really carefully to them because something about me is hurting, and I don't want it to hurt anymore. And I listen attentively to what they say. And almost without exception, whatever they tell me to do, whatever medicine they tell me to take, whatever therapy they tell me to employ, I do because I don't want to hurt anymore. And I trust that that physician knows more than I do about what's wrong with me. Why in the world will we treat our relationship with God any different than that? He is the great physician, the one who wants to heal our lives, the one who created us to be in relationship with Him, to give us joy and a future, a promise for a hope and meaning and purpose, both here and hereafter. I would be a fool if I would go to a doctor and say, doctor, this hurts. And he says, well, we can fix that if you do this. I'm like, nah, I got a better idea. I know a lot of people like that. I know people that go to the doctor, and the doctor says, do this and don't do this, and they go, and they go home, and they don't do this, and they do this. They reverse it completely. And I want to take those people and say, you just dumb, sister. Brother, you know this guy went to school for like 28 years, so he would know more than you about this? And you're talking about, you have the nerve to fuss about your whatever not working or this doing that? Shut up. But we do the same thing spiritually, do we not? We read the prescription in the Word of God for a life that is healthier and happier and fuller, and we say, nah, I got a better idea. I got a better idea. Christy and I need to go to a financial planner because we want to make sure that our future is secure so we're not a burden on our kids. When we go to the financial planner, and he or she says, here's what you need to do, we'll have a choice. What are the choices? Do it or don't. But I don't get to fuss about the results if I don't. My life sucks. Are you following God? Nah, shut up. That's not a kind, compassionate, pastoral word, but it is what I'm feeling right now. The Bible says you deserve what you get. I'm terrified by this passage in Deuteronomy. I am jarred by this passage in Deuteronomy, both personally and within my family and within my nation, when I look at these things and say, if we don't follow what God commands, these are the clear results of our choices. And we're starting to see those things come into fruition all around us. The line between what we see and read as promises as opposed to what we consider curses is paper thin. Both, when their origin is from God, are certainties, not possible outcomes or weak pledges. They are guarantees. Both are indications, whether we like it or not, of the love of our God given to us through the gift and curse of free will. Don't you just wish that sometimes God would make you do the right thing so you didn't have a chance to mess it up? But the gift and curse of free will is that we get to choose, and both are powerful and comprehensive and beyond what a human can deliver upon, as they are equally given by God as a promise or a curse. We are able to choose. But as for me and my house, we will choose this day to serve the Lord. Father, thank you for the stark reminder of the absolute promise of your blessings when we follow you and abide by your commands. And Father, I even thank you today for the terrifying reminder of your punishment and the natural consequences of when we don't follow your commands. Thank you that today, even right now, we can turn completely from our sin and rebellion and face you. Not in 6 months, not in a year, not after trying something. We can literally decide today to follow you and to abide by your commands. Father, I ask that you impress on our hearts the things that you would have us change and alter and do. And Father, we thank you for loving us enough to both give us the awareness of the curses and the promise of the blessings. We thank you for letting us pray in Jesus' name. It is in his name we pray. Amen. We will be starting house church back up, but it'll not be this evening, and I'll let you know when that is. And we are going to be contemplating back our in-person meeting at some point, but I am still uncomfortable with doing that right now. We will see how that'll go shortly. So thank you for joining us in person. Those of you that do the music and the tech and have to ride in the car with us, that do the music and the tech. And for those of you that are joining us virtually, we love you. Hope you have a great week in the Lord.